open up the discussion. Thank you all for being here with us today. Perhaps, Mr. Kant, you can help us share with us, given that you have this vision of where the country is going and how to get it there, and you have experience all the way grassroots, being a district magistrate in Kerala, to being the head of NITI Aayog. Please share with us what you think about what's needed and what's being done.
Thanks, Sushil, for that introduction. You know, I'm particularly delighted to be in Hubli and to see this tremendous vibrancy and energy and this great ecosystem of institutions and the Deshpande Trust that has been built up here. I never expected this, honestly, so I'm really delighted to be here and delighted to get away from Delhi to be here. And secondly, I'm really fascinated at this largest incubation center which Desh got his father, who must be a very proud father, to inaugurate. And so I'm really, you know, fascinated with this whole incubation center, and I wanted to not merely compliment Desh but also the architect who's brought in so much of light and fresh air. And I hope he brings light and fresh air to some buildings in Delhi also, you know. So it's really nice, you know, so to be here, and wonderful. So Sushil, I think the challenge really is that we are, you know, as a country we are growing at 7.5%, but the challenge is to grow at higher rates, 9 to 10%, 3-decade period, year after year, year after year, to lift a very, very young population above the poverty line. And it's important to understand this, that you know, we're passing through this window of demographic transition which rarely happens in history. Almost 70% of our population is below the age of 35, a very light dependency burden. And the challenge is that if you have to grow at 9 to 10%, you can't do this by leaving a vast segment of our population outside the growth process. And therefore, you know, while in Silicon Valley, you have a number of innovators, a vast number of innovators, the world's most dynamic innovators are all in Silicon Valley, but there are no challenges. And all the challenges are here in this country of 1.3 billion. So we do a program called the Aspirational District, which is to transform 115 backward districts of India. We don't call them backward, we call them aspirational districts, where we are monitoring change on a real-time basis, minute to minute, minute to minute, and Tata Trust is one of our partners there. And you know, the challenges are enormous in India. How do we provide water which is fluoride and arsenic free to our citizens? How do we ensure that our farmers are able to get, you know, enhance their productivity based on soil and weather conditions on a real-time basis, so that productivity can take a 30% jump? And if we can increase our yield to levels of China and wheat and rice, then you don't need half of your agricultural land. Or you know, huge challenges on the health side, massive challenges on infant mortality, on maternal mortality, huge challenges on learning outcomes. Class 5, almost 40% of the students in class 5 are not able to do simple addition and subtraction of class 2. They're all passing away, going up and up and up, but learning outcomes are very poor. Or almost 28% of the students are not able to read their mother tongue. So there's something going wrong in these districts. And therefore, all the challenges are in India. And I think if we are able to find solutions to the problems of India, of 1.3 billion people of India, we are not finding solutions for the 1.3 billion people, but we are actually finding solutions for the next 7 billion people of the world who will move from poverty to middle class in the next decade. So there's a huge market outside of 7 billion people of the world for whom we have to find solutions. And therefore, my view is that this is not possible unless and until you don't disrupt the Anglo-Saxon system of education that we have inherited, and that is that passing classes year after year, year after year. So one of the things that we have really tried to do, one of the two critical things which we are really trying to do in NITI Aayog, one is we've created about 3,000 tinkering labs in schools where we are providing robots, 3D printers, Internet of Things, all from class 6 onwards. And we are having a huge number of mentors who are going around training the students. And they work with teachers, because teachers also, their mindset needs to change from books to innovations. And all these tinkering labs are actually doing unique things. Many of them are really, from class 6 onwards, students are doing very, very innovative things. And our challenge is to really build up by 2022 to create about close to 35,000 tinkering labs all over India, so that students become innovators. And they are able to disrupt India in a manner which the world has never seen before. And unless we don't do this, we don't change the status quo, we don't disrupt, India will never be able to grow at rapid rate on a consistent period for a long period of time. And the important thing is to find solutions. And secondly, not merely tinkering labs, but we are supporting a vast number of incubation centers. We've supported close to about 25 incubation centers across. And thirdly, we are running a number of grand challenges. And my view is that the solutions to the problems of India will not be found by government institutions. They will never be found by scientific research institutions of government. They'll be found by the people of the world if you pose those as challenges to the world and support those people who are finding solutions, the best of them, support them, handhold them, facilitate them, catalyze them, and ensure that there is a market for that product. So we are running a vast number of grand challenges for them. That's on the tinkering lab side. On the other side, what we are doing is that we've building up, I think the important thing to understand is that we've built up a very complex, complicated and a difficult India. Over the years, we've added a lot of rules, regulation, processes, procedures, so that, so many of them that we find the private sectors, we've made it very difficult for private sector to create wealth. So one of the key things we are doing is to dismantle a lot of them. We've dismantled 1,300 laws. We've made it easy to start a business. Number of firms for import-export have gone away. So this is work in progress. We've jumped up 42 position in the World Bank ease of doing business. But India is a very large country. It's bigger than 24 countries of Europe. So the challenge was to make the states compete and rank them on ease of doing business. So we've created a huge sense of competition among states on education, on health, on so that states must compete. And thirdly, we're trying to transform these 115 most backward districts of India. And there the challenge is that how do we monitor them on a real-time basis? When I was collector in Kerala and Calicut, we used to work with data which was 7-8 years old. We are now capturing data on a real-time basis, created a dashboard so that on 49 indicators across agriculture, education, health, and entrepreneurship, and skill development, we are able to capture the change on a real-time basis and put it before the district. So every district knows where they are failing and why some districts. So what we've compared is a district and where it is in all these indicators right now, how does it perform, and which is the best performing district in that state, and which is the best performing district in India. And our target is to push these districts to the best performing district in the state in 3 years' time, and in 5 years' time, put this district to the best performing district in India. And it's not possible for government alone to do this. So we are working with a number of NGO partners. We are working with TATA Trust, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. We are working with Piramal Foundation, all of them, to actually do transformation on ground, to handhold the collectors, to push for change. And our objective is that this monitoring on a real-time basis, naming and shaming, There are huge challenges on health side, huge challenges on education side, but we've really challenged the states, we've challenged the district collectors, we've challenged the Zilla Parishads, all of them, so that they can all compete with each other, and we are able to provide support so that we can take this. And if these 115 districts we are able to transform in the next 3 years, then India will be able to do growth with inclusiveness, which to my mind is very important. You can't have growth without inclusiveness, and therefore we'll be able to bring in a huge amount of inclusiveness in our growth process.
Thank you very much. Hello, can you hear me? Yeah. Thank you very much, Amitabh, for setting the stage, as it were, the various things, the various challenges, the various opportunities and challenges such as bureaucracy, which is being reduced. There's so much in there that we could go off in 10 different directions. But there are two directions that come to mind, and I think the panelists can take them up. The first is that, you know, you mentioned the very striking growth rate of 7%, etc. We've actually now been growing faster than China. China grew for a long time at a much faster rate. As we probably all know, there was almost like a 1,000-year period in the history of the world when India and China together used to account for more than 50% of world GDP. This is a long, long time ago. But then, you know, lots of circumstances and politics and things, the Europeans took over. And now we are coming into an era when India and China have risen and are becoming powerful forces. But the interesting thing is that China liberalized a good 10, 12 years ahead of us and really got its house in order and has taken off. And is now actually the largest economy in the world if you use purchasing power parity, ahead of the US. And so one thought that occurs to me is perhaps Desh can help us think about this, and Manoj as well, because he's got very strong international experience, is that what is it that China did, or other countries, Desh, like Israel, where you know, you're very closely involved with entrepreneurship in Israel as well through Mass Challenge. What is it that other countries have done that we can learn from? Before we become too complacent about our success, we have dynamic people like Amitabh trying to help things along, but I'm sure he's also thought about this. But Desh, what do you think? How do you compare this with other countries?
Well, Sushil, you know, as Amitabh talked about, there's a lot of grand challenges, but I feel very optimistic that we can solve them if we, and the other countries have shown that it can be done. So what have they done? Number one, things have changed dramatically in the last 40, 50 years. You know, I graduated from IIT Madras 1973. I majored in computer science, but I'd never seen a computer in my life before. So the difference, the access to technology was very limited because it was very expensive. And what's happening now is that everybody has access to technology. If you look at people in Hubli, whether it's BVB College, IIT Dharwar, or this incubation center, most of the people have access to lots of the different tools, the technologies. And that's only going to get better as time goes on, because I see the advances that are going on in nanotechnology and a whole bunch of other things, which are only going to make things more powerful and cheaper. So the tools are going to be available. So places like Israel, they made all these tools available for the entrepreneurs. But you're still trying to do something that people haven't done before. So that's innovation. And one of the fundamental things about innovation is that you can fail. And so it's a cultural issue. You know, I think if you have a culture where you only look for success, you cannot be an innovator. Because I think innovation is all about coming up with an idea, experimenting with it. You don't know whether it's going to work or not. And if it works, you move on. If it doesn't work, you regroup. And so the only thing that you can add to that process to be more successful, if you have to fail, if you are in a wrong approach, you want to fail small and you want to fail fast. And that process happens if you innovate collectively. You know, for example, in Israel, Silicon Valley, all these places. So what happens is, if let's say if there was only one entrepreneur in Hubli, and he came up with a fantastic idea, he would work on that idea for 2 years, and then at the end of it, he would know whether it's working or not working. But if you had 1,000 entrepreneurs in Hubli, and he has a brilliant idea, but then he communicates and talks to all the 1,000 people, he doesn't have to go through 2 years. And he doesn't have to spend a lot of money actually doing it, because the ideas will iterate, and he will know right away whether it's a good idea or not a good idea, maybe he should do something differently, and so on. The other piece is the mentors, you know, people who have walked before. Every entrepreneurial journey is unique, and nobody else can sort of tell you exactly what to do. But people who have done it before, you know, if you want to climb Himalayas, it's still pretty risky. But people who have been there before can share their experiences so that it can help your own journey. So what those countries have done well is creating tinkering labs so that people have access to a lot of the new ideas, new things. They've created a culture of failure and success, where failure is okay. And as long as you're working hard and experimenting, that's what gets credited. And they've created this fantastic network of mentors, where the mentors and the entrepreneurs work together to come up with new ideas and access markets.
Great, thank you, Desh. As I was thinking about the tinkering labs, Amitabh, you were mentioning, we are seeing, I go around and meet lots of incubators, and I'm seeing a lot more of those labs, and they are being fanned out. And actually, I've seen even the online or sort of soft versions of that. And one of those companies I saw in Bangalore, Lab in an App, was incubated right here in Dr. Shetter's campus, BBB college campus. It's amazing how the innovation is not just in the metros, it is also in the smaller cities, just as it is global. And I think, Manoj, you've actually been an entrepreneur yourself, and you've seen innovation in the best innovation around the world. And also currently, as a person with an incubator, you are probably seeing things at a level that it's very difficult for it's very senior government officials to see. As we know, Amitabh, one of the challenges we have is government has great ideas. Government actually has a fair amount of resources, and those resources get deployed in to pursue those sensible ideas. But the biggest challenge that if you meet any secretary in government of India, and I've met many of them, is that they talk about the implementation challenges. And part of that you're fixing by removing the bureaucracy. But the rest of it is also the culture of the people, not just the bureaucrats, but others, college principals, teachers, and so on. And similarly, for incubated companies to really blossom, it can be really challenging to actually make things happen. And actually, Manoj has a very interesting approach. He kind of rolls up his sleeves and makes it his responsibility to make his company successful, of course, using mentors and so on. And also, Manoj, I hope you can share your what you told me about a very remarkable innovation with the MRI invention. So I won't preempt you, but...
Thank you, Sushil. So, you know, as Amitabh laid it out about we are growing fast, but at the same time, we cannot leave a lot of problems unresolved, you know, and they cannot be the byproduct of growth, or they cannot be left alone. Think about healthcare, education, water, sanitation, agriculture, all these sectors. Now, when we started looking at social alpha architecture in Tata Trust, one of the key element, of course, is innovation, but also entrepreneurship and investment, right? So if you look at these three distinct areas, see, who has been the biggest risk taker in this country historically? Government. Right, every big industry has been built by government, whether it's Indian Railways or, you know, any public sector undertaking, right?
Indian Post Office.
Everything, right? So we are so used to expecting all the solutions from government historically that we believe that if something is not working, government will do it, right? In today's world, right, where private capital is slowly getting into sectors which were earlier reserved for government or philanthropy, we still have a big problem. The big problem is the quantity of capital and the risk-taking ability, right? if you see that industry, most of the big industrial players or startups are not in healthcare or not in agriculture, there is a reason behind that. The reason is it does not meet their risk return expectation, right? Any investor expects a certain amount of return on the risk they are taking. By definition, because we do not have huge cases or precedents, investing in drug discovery or healthcare diagnostic devices or agriculture technology or water or sanitation, we assume that it's extremely risky, and therefore when investors look at sectors, it's always easy to invest in retail or carpool applications than in a diagnostic device, right? So the trade-off is very easy. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to create an ecosystem where we can focus on three things. One, innovation. And when we say innovation, innovation for whom? Are we innovating for clean, safe drinking water, or improving the productivity of small and marginal farmer, or improving access to education, right? Now, how do we take this innovation to market or the consumer, right? This lab to market enablement ecosystem is currently broken. So if I am an innovator in IIT Bombay and I develop a new aerospace technology, it's very easy for me to license it to Boeing, and Boeing in their R&D lab can do the lab to market enablement, create the solution, take it to market. So in mainstream industrial world, this is not broken. Academia, research centers, and industries are very closely linked together, and they work very proactively. But if I develop a new technology for sanitation, right? If I develop a toilet where it can run with minimal water resources and decomposition is not an issue, and I am looking for someone to commercialize it, that's the problem. So lab to market enablement ecosystem has to be built, and that's what we do in Social Alpha. We look for innovators who have ideas for solving India's complex problems and help them incubate those innovations into startups. Second is entrepreneurship. Not every entrepreneur is willing to work in complex development areas, right? So how do we encourage those entrepreneurs to come and work in sectors which are not very glamorous, right? By subsidizing some of the risk they may be taking. At the end of it, the core of entrepreneurship is risk taking. But if you can find ways of de-risking their exposure, they may be interested in doing it. So how do we provide entrepreneurs an environment where they are reasonably confident of getting this ecosystem access and support the way Deshpande Foundation has done in Hubli? But the third and most critical element, which is still unresolved, is investments. There are many ways you can get your idea funded, and the simplest is the grant, right? With 5 lakh, 10 lakh or 50 lakh rupees investment, you can do maybe one or two prototypes, right? But if you have to create a commercial grade solution that you want to take to market, and you have an idea that you can demonstrate, you have a working prototype, now you want to do design for manufacturing, now you want to create a product that is meeting benchmarks on affordability, accessibility, as well as user experience, where is the capital? And that should come ideally from private sector. But if you look at venture capital models which are there in the market today, they are looking for much lower risk. So the risk appetite of capital that's available today is very low. So that is why if you see impact investment portfolio in the country, you will see 75 to 80% of the portfolio is microfinance. Because microfinance as a sector has proven itself that it can generate 10% return on assets, so people increasingly invest in microfinance. So if you are in services, if you are in microfinance, retail, e-commerce, you will still get funded. But if you are building a diagnostic device or a new technology for water purification, that is where the challenge is. So what we realize that level of venture capital or impact capital doesn't exist in the country today, and that has to be created. So if we can create a layering mechanism of capital where initial funding happens through incubation, seed capital or grants, but at later stage you have high risk capital that can underwrite the risk, then eventually these models, if they are de-risked, the VCs and impact investors will come in and invest. We need a seamless ecosystem so that an idea can move from lab to market or community without falling in valley of death. And actually the valley of death is not one. This could be multiple valleys of death every 6 months or 1 year when your cash flow goes away. So I think one of the areas where we need to focus, and actually government, private sector, philanthropy, corporate CSR all need to come together, is to create that extremely high risk pool of capital where we are willing to make big bets. And I'll give you one example from what we have done in Social Alpha. So we have 35 incubating companies in our portfolio. We haven't given everybody equal amount of money. But there is one company, and we could afford to do only one. I would love to do it with 100. There is one idea which was to create world's first liquid helium-free MRI machine with 1.5 Tesla magnet that would do whole body scanning. And we have invested 15 crore rupees till date, and we are getting into human trials, and I believe we will spend another 10 crore before it goes to market. So if you are really creating a commercial great solution, which is, and what is it doing? It is reducing the cost of MRI at least by 50%. It's making it portable so that I can put it on a truck and take it to any village in the country. And it's four times faster than GE, Siemens and Philips, their products in the market. So it's really a disruptive innovation that will go to 7 billion people, as you mentioned, Amitabh, and not just to 1 billion in India. But in our kind of frugal environment, we are thinking of 20 to 25 crore of investment in this before it actually goes to market. Now, if you want 100 product startups in this country, before VCs and impact investors can come in, we need a larger pool of extremely high risk capital that can be betted on these startups. I think that is the missing piece of our, you know, startup strategy. If we can fix that, then lab, incubation, acceleration, investment and growth, we would have built the full ecosystem. And this full ecosystem stack, I think, you know, with NITI Aayog's help, I think we can build this in the country.
No, so that's a very, very valid point which Manoj has made. See, government is good at certain things, government is very poor at certain things. So what the government has done is it's created a fund of funds. We looked at the experience of different countries around the world, and we created a 10,000 crore fund of funds, which is operated by, actually the board is run by private sector people, and it operates out of SIDBI, but the intention is to support a lot of venture funds. You know how Israel became a startup nation was that they started with two venture funds, but they eventually grew. They created the ecosystem for many venture funds to grow, and the venture funds in turn supported a huge startup movement. What the government has here tried to do is to create the right ecosystem for startups, but on the funding side has created a fund of funds which will support many venture funds, which in turn will do their due diligence to support startups. And so what we are seeing is that venture funding is enhancing, but on the social innovation side, there is a huge challenge which Manoj talked about. And I think what he said is critical. And what we are seeing in India today is also a lot of unique social innovation taking place in India. I mean, there's one girl, Pranju Bhandari, who started with Hello English, has taught 9 million Indians how to speak English in 1 year. No school, no college has been able to do this. Or look at what Portia, Practo, Consio Medical, or Mitra Biotech are doing. I mean, some of them are, Mitra Biotech is relocated from Silicon Valley into India for personalized cancer care. Or Consio Medical, I was not aware that there are 100 million people suffering from huge issues of stool management, because nobody talks about this issue of stool management. There are 16 million people in India who suffer from this issue, but Consio Medical has very successfully found solutions to those issues. And many, many other challenges, or 3D Netra, I met the gentleman here, but I've been seeing their progress. A lot of innovation in eye care and eye testing. So a huge amount of work. Or look at even on the field of education. A lot of disruption is happening. And you know, the challenge really in many of these social innovation is much like what Uber, you know, because the learning outcomes are very poor, much like how we track Uber car on a longitudinal and latitudinal basis. If we are able to track every single child on a longitudinal and latitudinal basis to say how is he moving up on the learning curve, and we are able to track every single child and handhold them to enhance the learning outcomes, will radically improve in India. And therefore, I think a lot of unique work is happening in India. I mean, So we just need to create the right ecosystem to give it a further fillip, which Desh is doing here in Hubli. And I personally feel that a lot of these great initiatives will come from tier 2 and tier 3 cities and not from the existing metros of India. The existing metros of India will only keep doing retail, or they'll do very commercial work, but real solutions to India's problems will come from tier 2, tier 3 cities. From Atal Innovation Mission, we'd done this grand challenge between students of IIT Delhi, a public school from IIT Delhi, and slum children from Delhi. We gave them, we ran a challenge around them, and actually the best solutions to the problems came from the slum children of Delhi, who actually beat the public school and the IIT Delhi, because they came up with solutions which they were confronted with, which was about drinking water and converting waste into compost, where their whole slum colony was surrounded by waste. So once you open this whole Pandora of opening up, asking children to find solutions to their problem rather than studying and passing classes all the time, you will make India a very, very innovative society. And I think we need to disrupt India in a very major way. And I think the biggest disruption which India needs is in the field of education, more than anything.
No, I think it's and it's doable. You know, it's not, and it doesn't take that much time. You know, right now we always look at US and say, look how easy it is to do things. But that wasn't the case. When I started my first company 30, 35 years ago, there was no venture capital. You know, the biggest venture capitalist would be $20 million. So before they gave a check for $1 million, they wanted to make sure that you mortgaged your wife, your kids, and they wanted to make sure that you hurt more than they did if you didn't work out, right? So the cycles used to be very long. You had to go without a salary for a whole year, and if it failed, you took a big hit. So the experimentation cycles used to be pretty small. But within 30 years now, I mean, there's a lot of venture capital, and a lot of the people who have made money are into angel investing and so on. So I think it's all developing pretty quickly in India, and I'm glad that NITI Aayog and Amit and so on are really, it's all reducing the friction. Nobody can guarantee success, but you can make sure that you're more likely to succeed. But there's always a risk. You know, the best analogy that comes to my mind is childbirth. Because there are 7 billion children born, right? And so, like, as a stranger, you look at it and say, what's the big deal? You know, somebody's pregnant and there'll be a kid, they'll be born. We just had our first grandkid, so I went through a little bit of that. Was a second grandchild, yeah. So, but for the parents, it's a big roller coaster ride until the last minute it happens. And there'll always be a story, you know, if only I hadn't made this turn there on the road, you know, maybe I won't be in the hospital, and so on, right? So for every entrepreneur, it's always a risky journey, and it's unique. But at the same time, if you looked at 100 years ago when we didn't have hospitals, childcare, diagnostics, all this stuff, a lot of the children, you know, there was a lot of fatality, a lot of things failed. But come 100 years later, now the systems are so good that very rarely do you lose a child, right? So entrepreneurship is similar to that. Every journey is going to be its own roller coaster ride, and every entrepreneur has to go through his own experience. But we can all help the ecosystem so that it's more likely that the entrepreneur will succeed. So it's all about reducing the friction of success.
I just wanted to touch on this point which Desh had made earlier, and which is about using technology to leapfrog, which is to my mind very critical, because a vast number of technologies which are not accessible to the developing world are today accessible. I mean, we're the only country in the world with 1 billion mobile, we're the only country with 1 billion biometric, and we're the only country with 1 billion bank account. I mean, just to give you an example, you know, State Bank of India, for instance, took 100 years to get 500 million customers. 100 years to get 500 million customers. You know, when I was working in the traditional fisheries sector of Kerala, and my job was to reduce the number of middlemen and enhance the returns to the traditional fishermen. And we provided fishing crafts, nets, outboard motors to self-help groups of fishermen. But the toughest job was to open bank accounts for fishermen. Chasing physical bank managers and banks was the most difficult job. It used to take me 10 months, 11 months to open a bank account for individual fishermen. Know your customer was a nightmare about it just 7-8 years back. Today, you know, I mean, 2 weeks back, a handheld device, one of the bank guys walked into my room and opened my account in 55 seconds flat. So from 11 months to 55 seconds has been the paradigm shift in India on account of technology. And while it took State Bank 100 years, Paytm has done the, you know, close to 200 million accounts in about 18 months' time, and by 2020 they will have 500 million. So they'll achieve in 3.5 years what State Bank took 100 years. You know, so that this is the level of disruption that is happening in India today, and this is this kind of creative destruction that will happen, a huge amount of disruption that will happen because of technology. And while we are seeing this happening, and I, to my mind, because we are pushing the limits of digital payments in India, and all of us, many of us are using mobiles for all our payments, you know, it's we started off with this Bheem app, which government actually innovated the Bheem app, and you know, soon thereafter we saw Google come up with Google Tej, WhatsApp come up with WhatsApp payment, we've seen Samsung Pay come in, and you know, so what we are seeing is on the back of this, a lot of private sector initiatives coming up, and to my mind, in the next 4 to 5 years, India will be the first country in the world which will make debit card, ATMs, all technologically redundant. We'll all be transacting through our mobile phones, which will become ubiquitous. So I think because of biometric, because everybody one having Aadhaar, look at what government has done. And it's very important to understand this whole trajectory of what digitization is doing to India. Because India used to be one of the most inefficient countries for providing benefits to traditional fishermen, traditional people, you know, to beneficiaries in India. And many of you would remember Rajiv Gandhi's statement that only 15 paisa reaches the beneficiary. Today we do 500 schemes of government of India, from scholarships to salaries to everything. All benefits are transacted, money is put straight into the bank account of the beneficiary. 500 schemes, it's led to a saving to the government of close to 90,000 crores. And to my mind, India today is one of the most efficient country simply because of digitization. Public finance management system, everything, every single transaction that we do in government goes till the last point is a digital payment. You can track it down to the last payment. Without that, money cannot be released. 99.1% of people pay income tax on online in India. It's not seen, not even in United States of America does this happen, what India has achieved. So India needs to be really proud of what it has achieved in digitization, you know, across many things. And look at what we've, you know, GST, one tax across the country, there's maybe some teething issues, but it will throw up so much of data across India, and this will lead to so much of data analytics, and this will lead to financial inclusion in due course. We won't, physical banks will be dead, physical bank managers will be dead, there will be no need for banks. It'll all happen on the basis of data analytics, and all on the basis of all on merit, financial inclusion will take place in due course. So India is going through some of the biggest, one of the biggest disruptions the world has ever seen, and all of us as Indians need to recognize this and must be proud of it.
This is the day I feel very glad that I turned down a banking job when I came out of IIMB Ahmedabad and went to join the Tatas instead, because I'd be dead very soon. So I think that one of the things we really like to do is have this wonderful, energetic conversation. Thank you so much, panelists. Also respond to questions, concerns from the audience. And we have fortunate to have almost half an hour, 25 minutes for that. I do have a couple of, you know, I used to be a professor. I'm still kind of a professor. And I can be quite ruthless in a professorial way. I have a couple of requests from those who's asking questions. One request is that it has to be a question. I know that you are very capable of sharing lots of suggestions. And I'm sure NITI Aayog and the rest of us have channels through which you can make suggestions. So please don't take the forum to make a long speech. Please simply ask a question. Of course, you can say something to stimulate the question. That's fine. And the second thing I've learned is that people come up with multi-part questions. When we say only one question, they say, question, well, it's only one question, but A, B, C, D, E, F. Please, please ask just one question, because there are many people in the audience who would like to ask a question, and you can always carry on a conversation later. So with those two requests, I'd like to open it up. Do you have any questions? Back there, gentleman who just stood up.
Hi, Amitabh. Hi, Manoj. Good morning. My name is Veer Narayan Kulkarni. I run a firm by name Millet Monk. I'm incubated with Sandbox here. Millet Monk is into providing millets. We have a millets restaurant here. So my question is with regards to the agriculture. So as I'm closely working with farmers and understand their problems, the target of doubling the farmers' income in the next 5 years is the target. And with the problems that we are seeing on the climate not being, we cannot predict the climate. So these are twin challenges. One is we want to increase the income. Second is the environmental problem. So what is the government doing in this direction?
See, the government has done many things on the agriculture side, but my view is that it will be very difficult. Government has done things like higher procurement price, MSP, many things, but my view is that it's very important that we need to push for greater productivity improvement in agriculture sector. And this would require a mix of better technology. This would require better cropping patterns, and this would require better water management. You know, agriculture consumes close to about 80% of our water in India. And, vast parts of India, Delhi, Haryana, Rajasthan, Punjab in particular, it's leading to vast desertification because we are digging deep down, leaving nothing for future generations, and reached a poisonous level of digging below. So sustainable, innovative agriculture in terms of technology is very important. Secondly, I think, to my mind, and I'm a great believer in the market, so I believe that markets have to function properly in the agriculture area. Agriculture sector is riddled with too many middlemen. It's exactly like the fisheries sector was till we introduced beach level auctions in Kerala. Too many middlemen, and unless we are not able to make ENAM work, that is, every market must be digitized, all the markets must be digitally linked to each other, the farmer must be able to know what is the price of his produce, and he must be able to sell at the best possible price anywhere in India. And thirdly, I think there's a huge need to do away with regulations, particularly on the Essential Commodities Act, so that there's free movement of goods across India. And fourthly, there's need for huge amount of value addition back to, from farm to fork. There's a huge need for value addition in India, so that value addition will eventually lead to greater benefit to the farmers.
Hello, this is Naresh. I'm a biomedical engineer from Hyderabad. Congratulations, Desh, for the fantastic facility. I'm really proud for the day. My question is mainly to Manish and Amitabh, sir. In Manish's point, he said the high-risk capital is missing, mainly for medical device innovation in the country. One side, government is after price controls, where like recently stents have been put into a price cap, which is fantastic. The other side, where in order to innovate with medical device, which is one of the high risk area, where the return of investment looked by VCs are very high. So what is the government looking at in this particular medical device innovation? Like today, world's first MRI is coming, liquid-free helium, only because the 2015 crores has been put. But like that, many things happening, but it has to be disruptive, widespread, where we have a lot of ideas and intellectual property. Just lack of funding, sequential funding, some of the innovations have been in the shelf.
See, this is true around the world. When you are innovating and creating products, by definition, it's high risk business, right? So if 20 people are targeting to create a new product, right? They are all competing for the same pool of capital, right? And capital markets are like very, very clear on where they want to invest, right? So if the risk capital is very limited, so for example, if I am a VC and I have limited amount of money and there are 20 companies competing for the same capital, I have to do two things. Number one, I have to make sure that I pick the best and let others fail very early, right? We cannot be very socialistic here that we distribute 10 lakh to all of them and then say who does better, right? So what happens, you have to first identify the best and see whether they can continue to remain on the top and innovate. So, you know, you have to exit very early, but at the same time, when you pick the winners, you have to support them. And that is where your ability to invest more and more in winners is extremely critical, right? So it's true for diagnostic devices, as you said, but it's true for every product business. Even software product companies are like that, right? So what will happen, there will be very few successful entrepreneurs in product business, but they will create disruptively large quantum of impact. They will create employment, they will create impact, they will be profitable, they will make a lot of money as well. But you cannot sacrifice that one winner by distributing your capital across 100 by saying each one of you take 10 lakh and come back next year and show me the proof of concept. Right? So the whole investment approach has to be extremely market driven. No. So it's available. So we have other companies in portfolio and there are other people also who are incubating. What I'm trying to say, as a country, we are at an early stage of a product innovation. In services, we have created Infosys, TCS long back, right? We have a history of being very good in services. But in product, we have limited success. We have to see more. Especially in hardware, we don't have many success stories.
So you asked this question about innovation and price control. And it'll be, if you want to push the limits of innovation, price control is not the solution. For years, India was doing price control on vaccines. India became totally independent in vaccines once it did away with price controls. You want to do price control, the solution is through government procurement. You want to bring down prices, do it through procurement, large scale. And in the case of stent, it was a different issue. The issue was that stent was coming at a particular price by the time it would be put by the hospitals into the patients, it will go up 100x price up. And nobody knew, there was no transparency between the imported price and between the price which the consumer was paying, and there were severe complaints from the consumers. But the intention is not to resort to price control everywhere. But one must also understand that India is also the pharmacy of the world. I mean, India has done huge amount of reverse engineering or innovation, whatever, to be able to provide medicine to the citizens of the world, including Latin America, Africa, and so on. Yeah. If India was not able to do this, medicine would never have been able to, vast number of people would have fallen below poverty line simply because medicine would not have been provided to people across the world at the right price point. So India has done enormously well in pharmaceuticals, you know. But now we need to become a far greater innovative nation in the field of pharmaceuticals and biomedicals and so on.
Can you comment on this whole challenge of product innovation, especially with lumpy investment?
Yeah, you know, I think my background is all products. I don't do service. And in the service sector, typically it's a cost plus business. So you get a contract, you work on it, and you make some money, and you can bootstrap and you grow with it. In product, it always takes a certain amount of time to innovate. And so you're saying, if I gamble on this particular innovation and get a product out in 2 years, maybe our there'll be customers who'll buy it. So it's a gamble. So you have to make the investment to actually see if you can get the product out and sell it. But you don't know whether it's going to sell or not. So it's a real gamble. And people who are not used to that mode of investment typically get nervous. So they make half the investment, and then it's never absolutely certain. And then they get nervous. And so a lot of the product companies fail because there's not enough investment to see the light of the day. And also, for a long time, India did not believe that they could do products. You know, I have only one company in India, a product company. It's called Tejas Networks. Started in 2000, year 2000. Most of the companies that started in US, they went public within 3 years, 4 years. One, Sycamore, was actually less than 2 years. So you could get something out quickly and get the buy-in and sell it and build a company. In India, you know, it took 17 years to go public. We just went public last year. So we went through the first phase where people in India would not believe that we could do technology that they could use. And then we went through the second phase. This is a networking product where we do optical networking, everything else, where people said, you know, if Indians have gone to US, they can do products, but people in India cannot do products. So all the Reliance, BSNL, Bharti, all of them got built with products that they just developed in Bangalore, but we had to sell it through Nortel. So we did the products in India, shipped it to US, and then it came back to India. Because people in India would not believe that the products made in India were globally competitive. But finally, we have gotten to the stage where people really believe that Indians in India can actually do products that are just as competitive and as good as what anybody can do in the world. And so I think it takes a little bit of time for the market also to start believing that the entrepreneurs here can actually produce products that are viable.
Hi, sir. My name is Dushyant. Actually, my startup, this is my second startup in health sector. And I'm trying to, my first startup. So my question to you is that, yes, Government of India has made opening up a company or an organization very easy. But closing an organization and, you know, starting a new one is becoming difficult, or it's not yet made so easy yet. So is there something NITI Aayog is doing on that?
I think you should read the new insolvency code. The new insolvency code has a whole focus on startups so that they can exit very quickly. I mean, the whole thing was designed, Vishwanathan, who drafted it, was specially asked to ensure that startups' failure should exit within 7 days, you know, because our belief is that Indians' psyche and especially Indian parents do not accept failures at all. And failure is a very integral part of the startup movement. So we made it a necessary part of the insolvency code, much like many of the big companies which are going through this insolvency proceedings. And one of the good things that's happened is for the bigger companies is that this crony capitalism in India will come to an end, because if you don't pay the banks, you'll lose your businesses. But for startups, we have a whole focus there that you can exit out much quicker, much faster. You don't have to go through the whole process. So please read the insolvency code.
Professor, I'll try to be very short. Question is, can we create a cell where the innovating companies here can approach to ask for level playing field for selling their products in India? This is the question. Little explanation I take on from Desh. There are many more now companies coming up after Tejas who have still stood, they have developed the products, and they are in a position to go to the market. And the question comes from that difficulty. And I'm worried, I'm concerned about the Sandbox and so many innovating companies. They will ultimately come out with a product which can disrupt. But once they come out with a product, and they don't find a level playing field to sell their products in the country, in our own country, then where do they go? Not many people have the resources or outgoing scenario by which they can tell that, hey, this is my difficulty. So where do they go? They don't get funded. They are not known. most of the SMEs are in a shell. Neither they know what is going on outside, nor nobody knows where they are. Their 90% of the time goes in calculating how I will pay next month's salary.
When we started the Startup India movement, one of the first things we did, because in India, you know, for every tender of the government, they ask for so many years of experience, you know, that you should have 15 years of experience, 10 years of experience and all this. The first thing we did, first order, and I'll make that order available, the first thing we did is that in the case of startups, as long as they meet quality standards, no experience should be insisted upon. That government must become the market for them. Unless you are not able to sell your product to the government, it will be very difficult for you to find the market. That's number one. So the first thing we did, and in any case, anywhere where any government department is not willing to buy your product, kindly bring it to the notice. We created a Startup India hub as a part of Invest India, where they were supposed to track every single such case. So if there's any such single case where government department is saying, no, we want experience, you are a startup, and therefore we'll not buy your product, please bring it to our notice, we'll take action on that. We'll force it. Second thing is, though I personally don't believe in protectionism at all, I'm a great believer that in a globalized world, you have to be an integral part of the global supply chain, but we've now given a huge focus to procurement from Indian companies.
We are not asking for protection. We are not.
No, no, I'm saying that government should buy your product. But government can at best say, what can government do? Let me tell you, I'm BHEL. I'm floater tender. I want to buy products. I'm saying that government, BHEL has been directed, all public sector enterprises have been directed to ensure that in the case of startups, none of them will insist on experience qualification.
Sir, my question was, where do we address this?
There's a Startup India hub. Okay. Startup India hub. If you Google Invest India, there's a Startup India hub whose only job is to do this.
So thanks. Thank you very much also for being brief and so on.
And I'll make that order available to you, by the way.
So he can write to that place, Startup India Hub, for the clarifications. I just want to note a little bit to add to what Amitabh was saying. I recently spoke with one of your colleagues, Subramaniam, who heads the MHRD, the Secretary MHRD Senior Higher Education. And he asked me, how can we help startups that are in EdTech? Because he knows I'm very interested in EdTech. And I said that we actually have, like I described the startups in Hubli also, we have very smart youngsters starting companies under the innovation programs that you're setting up. But the challenge they're facing is getting into school systems. And 1.1 million schools, I believe, in the country are run by the government. So your point is very well taken. The large market is government. But there's a challenge, and I think that's the challenge you're referring to, as to how do you remove the friction to actually get into the system. So I was saying, why don't you have kind of a conference like this, let these youngsters come, present what their product is, and I'm completely with you, let the market speak.
Yeah. You see, one more thing the government has done is to create the global e-market. And every single product which the government will buy online from GEM. And there's a separate window for startups there. So have a look at GEM, get your product registered there, and government has been told all government procurement will only take place in a transparent manner through GEM. It's one of the most radical and most revolutionary things which have been done in government. From buying cars to pens, everything will happen through GEM. So put your product there.
Madam, you want to?
Yes, thank you. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for this opportunity. My name is Lakshmi, and I think it's incredible the amount of things that have been done for the startup ecosystem. I've been an entrepreneur myself, and now I work with startups, helping them with fundraising. So my question is specifically from that aspect. We do have a lot of interest from NRIs, you know, foreign investors, angel investors specifically, who are interested. But there seem to be two questions. One is, of course, some of their host countries have a lot of subsidies for angel investments, which is something we haven't introduced yet in India. So I'd love to know what are your thoughts on introducing subsidies or support for angel investors, more tax support. The second question is the DIP IT certificate, for example, seems to restrict NRI investors. Just case in point is they need to provide a return of last 3 years of Indian investors, Indian return of about 25 lakhs, which obviously if they're NRIs, they will not qualify. So I think the DIPP IT certificate requirement, this is the very first ask, and how do foreign investors qualify here? These are my two questions.
So firstly, let me tell you that I'm totally against subsidies of any kind. The minute you start providing subsidy, you will kill the whole culture of innovation. Innovation does not happen on the mercies of government, and government, even if you provide subsidies, subsidy will never reach beneficiaries on time and will be badly delayed. So get this subsidy business out of your mind. India must do things to size and scale, and Indians must realize that the market is not the domestic market of India, the world is their market. No country in the world has grown without exports. Japan, Korea, China all grew out of exports. So all startups must start thinking big, they must start thinking large, that they're going to penetrate global markets first. And if you think that government subsidies will be there, forget it. The government subsidies will ruin you. And secondly, what the government must do is to facilitate, be a catalyst, create an ecosystem, provide a fund of funds. All that we've done something more additional, saying that startups will not be charged any tax for the first for 3 years out of their first 7 years. All that we've done several things on the startup ecosystem. And for angel investors, there was an issue of tax, which has now been sorted out by a separate circular. If there's anything still plaguing that and on the NRI, please put it in writing and give it to me, I'll get it sorted out.
We'll do that. Actually, I didn't mean subsidies, but I think for angel investors, if they have to write off losses, I think there's no provision right now for that. And I think that essentially, it will really boost angel investors because it is a high-risk investment, and it will also nurture more investors to come and support seed-stage capital, which is where they come in. There's a lot of opportunity.
I don't think angel investors have asked for this. All angel investors have asked for that they should not be subjected to a tax regime, Inspector Raj and all that. All that we've sorted out. All that we fully sorted out, but if there's anything still left, please bring it to my notice. I will take the initiative and get it sorted out. That's
Desh,
my response.
Desh, do you want to, Desh, as somebody who's used to other countries and the sort of investment atmosphere in those countries, do you want to comment on this?
Yeah, so what do entrepreneurs need? You know, when I used to co-chair the Council for Obama, there are four things we identified. One is you need a lot of good ideas, so you need an innovative environment. You need connections with good educational institutions and so on. You need good entrepreneurs. You need a lot of culture of a lot of entrepreneurs. You need a lot of mentors, and you need access to capital. So the access to capital, so we wrote a bill called the Jobs Act. And so what were the new things in there? Reducing the regulatory burdens, for example, Sarbanes-Oxley, you know, a lot of these things in US, we reduced them for small companies. And also, we facilitate this new crowdsourcing, you know, and that's actually, you know, there's still regulatory issues because if one poor grandmother loses money on an investment, it'll create a huge political issue. And so, but I think there's a lot of promise, you know, I think just like what we're seeing here in Hubli, where communities can come together and support things, if you can start facilitating. In some ways in India, it sort of happens in a micro thing. You know, a lot of the entrepreneurs here are funded by family and friends and so on. But I think we can make it so that because there's a lot of this capital available that people is buried in lots of places. And so I think there's a lot of creative ways that we can do it. But I'm with Amitabh. I think we should not provide subsidy. So
I think we're running out of time now, and we can carry on conversations, I'm sure, later on. I just want to make sure that we give Mr. Kant a couple of minutes to what is your recommendation, advice to the youngsters who are here, who are starry-eyed, trying to start companies in a second-tier city, which is not as attractive as the metros. You have any words of advice?
No, firstly, let me compliment the people of Hubli. You know, I've traveled all over India and I've lived in, tier two cities my entire life. And I have never seen the kind of energy and vibrancy and dynamism of Hubli. So, to my mind, Hubli from now onwards will be my favorite city. You know, and all the credit goes to the people of Hubli, but more so to, you know, the fact that you've been able to create a great ecosystem with Desh, creating this great, you know, India's biggest and the largest incubation center, it's unparalleled. I mean, I've spent so much time on in T-Hub, which is much talked about in Hyderabad, but T-Hub is completely dwarfs in flood. It's 1/10 of what you've created in Hubli. So this is, and I think the energy here is equally vibrant as compared to Hyderabad. So this is phenomenal infrastructure. But more than that, you have engineering institutes, you have IIT, you have Dharwad IIT, you have so many institutions, and you have such vibrant young people here. And many people coming from all parts of India to come to Hubli to mentor. I mean, this is unparalleled to my mind, totally unparalleled. And I feel very extremely proud of what is happening in Hubli. So this is absolutely phenomenal what is happening here. And I would only like to say that whatever we can do to push this unique ecosystem, I mean, people like you coming, people, so many people I met from someone from Goa, somebody from Bangalore, all people coming from all over India here to Hubli. So, and all trying to mentor young startups. So what do startups need? Startups need the environment, they need the ecosystem, they need facilitation, they need, this kind of an environment where we can facilitate things. So this is unique, and this is this hopefully will be become the biggest disruptor of India to my mind. So this is just phenomenal.
Thank you. Thank you very much for those comments.
And my compliments to Deshpande's father, who produced such a great son. and who's produced such a great son and who's done so much for his country and so much for his hometown. I mean, I've not seen any other person who's done so much for, creating an ecosystem all on his own. So he has done more than what any government could have done. And so I personally feel extremely proud of what I've, and I'm really delighted that I got out of Delhi and came here and saw this to myself. And this is, this really moves me no end.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kant, for those wonderful comments and the fact that you took the trouble to come here. We're very grateful also to the government for the Uran program that has given us so many more flights. I wish there was a direct flight from Delhi though.
So actually, it's starting from August 1st.
Excellent. So I'll request Manoj to also share a few thoughts as we conclude.
No, thanks. Thanks for inviting. I think this is probably the only city in India where you have a startup ecosystem of this scale and size. Bangalore, Bombay, Chennai, Hyderabad have been there for, several years. One of the things that, that entrepreneurs in cities like Hubli and even in smaller cities can do, because they are closer to some of the complex problems that exist only in, say, agriculture or others, that take advantage of new educational institutions like IIT, IIT Dharwad is a great example now. If you have, say, a portfolio of innovation, which basically is Jugaad innovation, how do you take advantage of new technologies and design for manufacturing and create good quality mainstream innovation that can be commercialized and taken to market? And a lot of times we see that there is no relationship between high cost and high quality. Actually, more and more new innovations are actually reducing the cost of and the price. We have a company called Incredible Devices based out of Chandigarh. They have reduced the cost of catheter by 99%, right? And it's being used in PGI Chandigarh now. So a lot of innovation can reduce the cost and still be of high quality, right? So that's very important, because if you want to be globally competitive, we cannot do Jugaad innovation. But Jugaad innovation is a market validation, because people who do Jugaad innovation, they do it because nobody is giving them a solution. So they do Jugaad innovation to solve their own problems. So this is a validation that the problem exists and people are trying to solve their problem. If intelligent engineers and innovators can take those Jugaad innovations and mainstream them by improving the quality, reducing the cost, making them more efficient, then they have a much more, much larger market to play.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, it's a beautiful building here. And I want to thank, and I'm very proud of architect Hiremat, Hegede, who actually built this whole thing, and Stanley, who actually made it all happen. So I'm very proud of this building, but let me tell you what will make me really, really proud. In another couple of years, if people can actually take advantage of this open architecture and start collaborating, entrepreneurs collaborating among themselves, attracting a lot of mentors from outside, and mentors contributing to the entrepreneurs, a lot of the venture capitalists coming here and saying, it's a great opportunity, let me invest in them, and all the educational institutions bringing their power of innovation and intellectual capital to the institution here. And as a combination of all this collaboration, there are companies that are being built that will really benefit the farmers and the students and SMEs and the educational system and so on. If you can really see that impact, I think Amitabh Kant, you're going to come back here in a couple of years and see all the impact, right? Great. And so that's what will make me really proud. So thank you.